It's close enough to 6 o'clock. We can start here. Starting the city council meeting for April the 26th, and as we always do, let's start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, did everyone have a chance to review the minutes from the March 22nd meeting?
Yes.
I had one correction, Shada. I sent it over to you, okay? It was just on the date of the orthopedics meeting, which was this afternoon.
Yes.
Do I have a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Second? Those in favor? Okay. Okay, and the Board of Public Works and Safety minutes were for information only. Anybody have any questions or concerns? Okay. Nothing under communications. Reports of our officers. Tom, you want to step up?
Good evening. The last month of March, structure fires, 3 in the city, snow fires, 1 in the city, vehicle fires, 1 in the city, 1 in Rochester Township, grass fires, 3 in Rochester Township, mutual aids, 2 to Henry Township, 2 to Union Township, station standby, 1 for Argus, title fire alarms, 2 in the city, 1 in Rochester Township, 1 in Richland Township, unauthorized burning, 1 in the city, 1 in Newcastle Township, meth lab, Rochester Township, accidents, 1 in the city, 3 in Rochester Township, 1 in Richland Township. We drove the ambulance from an accident scene one time. Medical assist, 15 in the city, 6 in Rochester Township, 2 in Newcastle Township. Drove the ambulance twice back to the hospital. Canceled calls once. We had a total of 50 calls in one drill. And just for an update on the application process, we had 16 applicants. We'll be testing on the 14th. We'll do a written test, and then we'll do a 2-mile run. We're going to do a SCBA drill, have them go in confined space down in the basement, do a search and rescue. We're going to have them climb a ladder, lock in, and work like they would off a ladder. We're going to have them climb the aerial, reach over, grab a rope, pull the section of hose about 50 feet for upper body strength, and we're going to do a hose drag. These will be timed or skilled and evaluated according to the engineering standards we use for teaching the mandatory 1 and 2 classes with. And we have written up a new protocol that there hasn't been a hire at Rochester Fire in the last 14 years, so we kind of reconstructed and put together a new program that will be the standing grounds for new applicants to come. Also, too, we'll be doing prom parking on May 7th. Rochester High School prom will be at Manchester College, and we normally go over there and do valet parking for the students, kind of make their night a little more special. And with that, most of the Class A's are in that we've ordered. Still have a few out, we're waiting on hats. The gentleman from Uniform House is going to call me, and I'll make a run to Indianapolis as soon as they get to the doorstep, pick those up for the guys. And then we're still waiting on the ear mask that we discussed. We did a fitting a couple months ago at the station. There's been a rush order the first year with Scott. They're a little behind, so we're still waiting on those to arrive along with the amplifiers. So that brings you up to date with our runs and then what equipment and issues and what's going on at the station. Depending on your questions, that concludes my report.
So you're confident the Class A uniforms will be here and available when we have the prom service?
That's what I got from Chris. He said the hats are ordered from another subcontract for them. They do the uniforms, the sewing, the alterations for the suits, basically. But they order the hats from another supplier. And he said he contacted them. They're supposed to be shipping this week, so I should be able to pick them up the end of this week or the beginning of next week and have them on hand.
Okay, make note of this, Tom. If the uniforms are here, but not the hats, let's have the guys go in uniform and not wear the hat, okay?
We will, yeah, we will.
Don't have anybody wear the hats then, okay? That's great, thank you. I think that's going to add to the prom, that's very nice.
Are any of the new prospective hirees, are they also qualified in any of the medical fields?
I don't think any of the applicants are EMT qualification. Everyone has CPR at least minimum. I was trying to talk with Jen to get an instructor and actually host a first responder course again at the station, but haven't got any feedback on that yet.
Thank you. Anything else for Tom? Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Well, let's shake it up a little bit. Lenny, come on up. For those of you who don't know Lenny, Lenny's our street department superintendent, supervisor.
We ship the brush and we did our recycling route that we always do, and we had helped put up a new sign for a pool and ordered up a new sign to put out there, so she can pretty much keep everybody up to date. Happened to know where the pool and stuff, so we went over there and helped get that in the ground and fix up and concrete it in. We fixed some holes that with the traffic picking up out of the boat launch, we developed some holes out there by the wastewater treatment station along the road there, so we went out there and fixed them up and got them all back in the smooth out and stuff. So we picked up some bags and still picking up the bulk leaves. We had repaired some alleys and we've done some street sweeping and patched some potholes, and we out of the crossing the Dairy Queen, we had to take that game plank off that we talked about, and we got that off to Craig Welding today to repair the pipe, getting that back in a couple days and get that pier back and going, so they'll all be up and working. And that's basically all I have for today. Any questions?
How about the vacuum machine going around town with the sewer lines and such? Report on that. Any of the progress on that?
Wastewater treatment plant.
The wastewater treatment plant. Mention anything about that?
They've been doing various spots, like on quite a bit out there on like Arrowhead and the trouble spots. We've been working on them. Like I think he was in the alleys today behind B&B getting them cleaned out. They was been pretty full of the dirt and debris that's filled up in them, so just been in various spots throughout the town getting them cleaned out and sucked out and operable again.
Very good.
Anybody have any? The storm basins.
The
storm water basins.
Yes.
The catch basins.
Yeah. Any questions for Lenny? Thank you, Lenny. Thanks. Good report. Okay, Derek.
The month of April, at the water board meeting, they approved the delinquent list for the month of April. I presented an update on the lighting project throughout the plant. All the lights are replaced and up and running. Looks great. I had the garage metal replaced on the front of the upper garage. That is 100% complete and looks awesome. I also presented an update on a water issue we had inside the plant. We had two aquamatic valves that were not operating properly. We had Peerless come in and fix those valves, and everything's operating fine there. I asked for a request for the approval to have Bob's Lock and Key come in and replace the doorknobs and the locks on all the well houses and also the plant itself. And the water board approved that for $4,725.80. And I will tell you that that is all done and completed. And they added extra security on some of the doors as well. I also presented an update on the fluoride room and the chlorine room. IDEM requested us move our chlorine pipes that were in the actual fluoride room into the chlorine room. That has all been done and completed. And we moved the phosphate tank and the phosphate scales and pumps into the fluoride room and just moved those around to make room for those. And IDEM has been back and says it looks great. I also presented an update to the board on the safety issues of chlorine. We're in the process of hooking up a red light on the outside of the building just for the safety aspects. If somebody comes down there and hasn't gotten the alarm call already, they would see that the light is on and not to go in. And we are in the process of also hooking up our chlorine alarm to our SCADA alarm system as well. Other than that, that's all I have.
Anything for Derek? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Warren?
I'm down at the wastewater plant. We got the boiler back online that heats the digester sludge. It's been about 20 years since we rebuilt it. It was cost $18,500, so hopefully it's good for another 20 years. The guys down at the plant have been mowing the yard, mowing lift stations, vacuum stations, and some other alleys and down at the Lions Club. They mow that too, so they've been busy mowing. The guys in the Aquatech, the back truck, they've been on the south side of town basically cleaning sewer lines on Wallace and Audubon. Down at the plant, 1st of April, we start disinfection season. That goes from April 1st to the end of October. So girls have been doing E. coli testing, and also they run the chlorine, which we have to take back out with sulfur dioxide. That's two more tests. Had the guys up behind cleaning the storm line between 8th and 9th, West 8th and 9th. We got some engineers coming up Thursday to look at that line for the property there at 9th and Main. Guys, we were up there cleaning it around 8:41. They got called back out. We had to help the water department with a water leak. I met with Duke today, Robin O'Neill from there. I took her back to the end of Jones Avenue. I had requests from some people. It's awful dark when you come out of the trail there by Woodlawn Hospital onto Jones Avenue. So they're gonna put a new light back there. And we've also, Mayor and I looked, probably what, a month or so ago?
About a month ago.
Yeah, Ivy Tech, and also there by the condos, we're gonna get a couple new lights installed there.
Just for everybody's information, and Warren will be too kind to say this, but I won't. We've had a real set down and come to understanding with Duke. We had a list of 26 lights that needed repair, and some of them going back before I was in office. The program got a little off tracks as to their maintenance program. They contract that out, and somewhere along the line we had some slippage there with Duke. They didn't have their maintenance things nailed down as good as they should have. Well, they attacked Rochester, yes, starting yesterday, didn't they?
Yeah, and what was that guy's name, Kevin?
Kevin Johnston.
Yeah, I think he had a little stern with
him. Well, no, we just had to point out that we were paying for a service that we hadn't been getting for some time.
Yeah.
So you're gonna see some brighter spots in Rochester now.
Yeah,
we're gonna continue to keep those spots lit, so. Anyway, that was a big venture yesterday. They attacked in force, so they should be finished up, what, by end of week?
I would hope so, they should be by the end of the week, I would hope so. But, moving on, I got the grid hydro, which is a piece of equipment we've had off and on. It takes grids like the material in wastewater that doesn't degrade and will break down with the bacteria process. we've got that back online, and we're just waiting for startup next week. We got the water line in, got it trenched back in, filled back up, so we're getting that started up next week. Because the grit, you let it go through the plant, it gets down the bottom, it goes through the pumps, and just acts like sandblasts the inside of the pumps, and wears all the impellers and stuff down. So it's kind of, it's really important to get that out. And I think everybody's kind of seen, I know Lenny and the guys worked with the storm drain, raising that up the corner of 5th and Main, the new ADA compliant ramps and the curbing and the storm drains and what they did. It's pretty nice how they kept the old paver bricks and put out in the area, which would be the tree lawn. They put those bricks in there. So it looks, if you haven't seen it down at 5th and Main, it's pretty nice. And last thing, I'm still working with IDM on our new permit. We'll be getting that July 1st. I'm kind of arguing back and forth some of the testing. They want us to test for copper, cadmium, chromium. They use a study with a creek. We go into Mill Creek, they use a study with a creek clear down by Indianapolis somewhere. It's been kind of arguing those numbers we're coming up with. I know we're going to do phosphorus, and we've been working with the engineers on that. Right there alone, the phosphorus is going to cost about $80,000 a year in chemicals, so to remove that, but we don't have any choice. Any plant in Indiana that's going to flow over a million gallons is going to have to do it. So.
But that beats $5 million to converting your wastewater treatment system.
Yeah, that's a little cheaper than $5 million. Yeah. So, unless you got any questions.
One point of clarification, you mentioned the 9th Street project down there, 9th and Main. Mm-hmm. We do, Warren kind of glossed through this, but we do have our engineering firm who is looking at our storm sewer situation. We have them coming to town to peruse that area down there in the design, because the design for that park is to be sunk 2 feet or so below the street level, make it a nice sunken area. We don't want a swimming pool there. So we're going to look at that very, very carefully and thoroughly to make sure it's engineered so that there's good drainage here, and we're not going to have a situation occur like that we didn't anticipate. Warren's involved with that.
Yeah, you and I and Lenny met up there. I think the other problem, like you pointed out too, there's still a cement. I think there's a cement floor clear down below all that dirt.
There's a base, so you've got to have some good drainage.
So yep. It retains water pretty good, so hopefully we can get that problem solved.
Any questions for Warren? Thank you, sir, and thank you for honchoing that Duke thing. I appreciate that.
Yeah, no problem.
Chief, save the best for last.
That's
here
right.
We go.
He's the only one with a gun.
Yeah. He's the only one with a gun, right? Yeah. Like that. Yeah. You never know nowadays.
Yeah.
That's
so sad.
Yeah.
Okay, for the month of March, we had 10 accidents. 9 of those were property damage and 1 was personal injury. We issued 84 total warnings, 41 total offenses, 19 traffic and 39 criminal, 4 juvenile. We had 40 total case reports with 602 calls for service, 39 lockouts, 5 towed vehicles, and 13 people incarcerated. And then you have the list of crimes that people are liable for by our officers. Other than that, our hiring process, we did do command staff interviews today, and 3 people will be moving on to interviews with the Board of Works Thursday 1. And the anticipation is that they will move into the regular session meeting and make their decision in that meeting. That way we can get a jump on this. Saturday is the boys' baseball parade at 8:30. And then the girls' softball parade at 9, so downtown will be a little busy Saturday morning. And then Sunday, the A8 motorcycle ride. They're going to line up, and we're blocking off the 100 block of East 8th Street. They'll line up the motorcycles up there, and I think they roll out about 11 o'clock or so.
They called and asked me to ride in the abate thing.
They have a sidecar for
you? You got the wrong mayor. You don't want me leading you, let me tell you. Yeah, sidecars.
We are going forward with that. It's going to be Sunday, May 15th. It filled up in about a week, so great turnout. As far as women signing up, we'll see how many show up, but I anticipate full class. And with the favorable comments that we've gotten in the past, I think we'll probably do a second one end of summer, early fall. And then police in the park, we're going to do that again this year. It's going to be Saturday, July 30th. We haven't picked out a movie yet, but it's going to be the same idea, show movie. I approached the park board, and they were okay with us using the park for whatever we need. We'll play a movie on the softball diamond, and churches are going to, I've already contacted a couple of churches that are going to donate some time and snacks and refreshments and things like that. So hopefully we'll have a good turnout.
Where are we advertising that? Where did you advertise it the last time?
Facebook mostly, but also the radio.
Oh yeah, so I've heard around town a couple of times people talking about what a great experience it was, and they just wish it had been advertised a little better.
Okay, we did it on WRY, and the newspaper had a little bit. I'll contact Channel 4 also.
We might be able to get a little help from Val on that. Yes? In the newspaper?
Oh, Wes.
Or Wes, not yeah. Val. Wes, I'm sorry.
Don't confuse him with sports.
Well, he's cut his hair.
I know.
Wes, I'm sorry.
Unless you have any questions, that's all I have.
We probably should let folks know at this time that you're interviewing for two officers.
We are.
Our process, one of our trainees that we had in training did not complete their probationary period, and that was a general agreement between the trainee and the chief. So we are moving forward for two.
We're down one anyway, so there is potential in the next couple of months that another officer may be leaving also, going down to the Noblesville area.
Any other questions?
Question for number three, with the more as they're arriving, as they got off the street, I understand what that means. You get cars off, people park there, get them off of there if possible, or?
Yeah, if we can. We're going to block, and Sunday mornings aren't terrible as far as traffic, but we'll probably put some barrels up around 6 a.m. or so. And do you park down there, don't you? Yeah.
That's good. One of the first things I can tell them.
Too. Okay. And yeah, if you just want to look around the corner on Ace on Main Street or something, that'd be great. We would appreciate that. I'm sure they would too. But like I said, I think it was about 11 o'clock. So I can just do that most of the morning.
Okay. So. They told me that they'd be out of there by 11:30. They believe they'd be completely out. So. Okay. Anything else for the chief? Thanks, Andy. Okay, reports of our committees, Area Planning Commission, Mark?
We did not have any business this month, so look for
what a surprise.
Wow. Pretty efficient board.
Wow. Yeah, moving down right along here.
Four others on that board.
Okay, Mr. Goodman, how about FEDCO?
Yeah, FEDCO met April 7th with a checking account balance reported of $80,871.73. Operating reserve balance $107,476.30. As far as local businesses goes, it's pretty much the same. Things are slowly picking up, but they're not as busy as they were last year, unless you're Rapid View, who seems to be setting records every time they report. The 9th and Main Street, I'm sure everyone's noticed by now that the property is filled. And the design's being worked on for the green space, you alluded to a little bit. Terry was looking at applying for a place-based investment fund grant through OCRA office. I haven't heard on the results of that. The Rochester Redevelopment Commission, we're going to meet the following Thursday and discuss putting another $25,000 in the project. Bob Peterson is donating the iron fence to put around the park. And the park they're talking about is the green space we're putting in. It's currently south of town on Indiana 25. I'm sure a lot of people would, I couldn't picture what he was talking about, but it's the old, it used to be an old school.
So it was the old county.
County.
Okay, that He's donating that iron fence to go around the green space.
Just to interject something there, I did not know this, but in conversations regarding that fence, before it was put around the poor barn, the poor home property, it was originally around the first courthouse. Yeah. Fulton County, when it was a wooden structure before it became the stone structure that it is today. So the fence is returning home, which is kind of neat.
If they can get it up. I hear it's put in there pretty well. There's also talk, Super 8's looking at, they're planning to do some upgrading out there. Ted mentioned that there's a group from Fort Wayne looking to possibly put in a hotel, a higher end hotel out south end of town. And American Axle is currently operating with 38 employees and running three shifts. They started shipping in November of 2015. They plan to have phase two for hiring in June or July or November. And they'll be looking to hire an additional 30 employees. And they said they've been very pleased with the employment market here so far. The final thing to report on is a Project Cardinal, and I can't remember if we brought this up last meeting. There was a lead brought to Terry about a gentleman interested in putting in a kosher candy and diabetic baked goods factory. He's currently looking at St. Joseph County, Elkhart, Kosciuszko, and Fulton. His plan includes a sugar beet processing plant, an emulsification plant, and the baking plant. Terry met with him the previous Friday, and they'll talk further about the project as he moves along. Still no update with Dean's, and pending your questions, that is the end of my report.
I don't know that you have anything to do with the wall at 9th and Main, but have you heard any more?
There has been no response from Mr. Lowe or Mr. McIntyre, but it is, the site's ready for them. They can get on there anytime and repair the wall.
There was talk they would be here April 1st, wouldn't it?
And last I heard from Terry, that was pushed to May 1st.
May 1st?
Okay. Yeah, I've got an update on that. Next Monday, Terry and I are meeting with Mr. Lau and Mr. McIntyre and discuss the details and the specifics of what they are proposing for the wall that they're going to put up.
They're not talking about steel again?
We're having some pushback there, and of course they know we do not have the authority, nor would we want to take the authority to do anything other than the brick wall that had originally been discussed. So those are going to be some serious discussions come next Monday. The other thing that I wanted to note that you mentioned in your report was what I had mentioned at the FEDCO meeting about a company out of Fort Wayne contacting us about an upscale hotel on the south end of town, some place on the corridor, if you will. We're getting people looking at us now with the corridor activity and such. Folks who were, you know, looking at hotels years ago and whatever, real estate companies and such, and the demographics just weren't there, want to revisit that, because with where things are proceeding with that 31 corridor, the demographics are going to change, they believe. So we're opening up some discussions there. It doesn't mean one's coming going to be built next year, but people are at least talking to us.
Another thing we've been hearing from local businesses is that the current choice of hotels we have aren't good enough. A lot of their customers are staying out of town in Plymouth, Logan Sport, and Culver. So it's one thing that Terry and Amy are looking at and working on.
Yeah, and even South Bend. Executives will come in, stay in South Bend, then commute down to Rochester. Shoots a good part of their day. So we've got some good discussions going on. Hopefully, I've always said that south end of town is going to develop with this process of the corridor, whether we're highly involved or not. But so we're starting to get some activity, some people interested in us. This is probably as good a time as any just to mention that I wasn't supposed to be here tonight, or I didn't think I'd make it back, but I have made it back. time for this meeting from the meeting with the OrthoWorks group up in Warsaw today. And that was Amy Rowe, our chamber director, Terry Lee, the Fedco director, and myself. And we met with Cheryl Conley, the chief executive officer in charge of the OrthoWorks group, who was the former president of offshore operations with Zimmer. Kathy Lamina, who was is the chief financial officer for the OrthoWorks group, who was a vice president of finance with Zimmer for years, and Brad Bishop, who was vice president in charge of community affairs with Zimmer for years, who is now in the community affairs and publicity area for the OrthoWorks group. We met with those three. We had a 1 hour meeting. We did a PowerPoint presentation on Rochester, Rochester today, what Rochester could provide tomorrow. And one of the slides we showed were all the industries that we currently have here. And we very obviously pointed out that of all those industries, there's no orthopedic presence in that group. And we want to change that. We're reaching out to them. They politely told us that they aren't the decision makers for the different industries, and I politely told them no, but they all knew David Dvorak, who was the president of Biomed Zimmer. Yes. They all knew Toby Buck, who owned Paragon Medical. Yes. I said, don't cut yourself short, people. You talk to these people, and they just smiled. So we had a good meeting, nice meeting, and we're planting seeds. Gave them a nice amenity bag from the different businesses in Rochester, participated. We had gift certificates from the Evergreen, from Giretti's, Schnabeltier, nice bottle of wine, Green Oak. There was a presence in there from Green Oak Antiques. They will have to come down here to spend those. And they've told us they're coming down to Rochester to take advantage of those amenities. And of course, our cards are all in there. They'll call us when they come, and we'll give them a 10-cent tour. So we're reaching out. It was a good day. Next on the list is the park board with Mason.
All right, park board met April 11th, and reports, nothing from the pool, with Lori. See, Lyle at the golf course said that numbers were low so far in the last few weeks prior to that. I'm guessing numbers are up since then because of the good weather, but bad weather had diminished them earlier on. That was the only golf course report.
Oh, I suppose.
And then we talked back about the bathroom quotes that we have been for the last few months. We're still in the process of figuring that out and making decisions there. New business, Donna Freisinger and Laura Manns asked us about dates for the Summer Parks program. We approved June 6th to June 24th for them for the Summer Parks program. We also were approached by Faith Outreach Church about the metal roof in the bathroom at the beach. They proposed that if we buy the material, they will do the work on it. We approved that as well. And as Chief Schatz mentioned, he approached us about the movie in the park on the July 30th, and we approved that as well. Any questions on that? Mayor, do you want to talk about the new appointment?
We had a resignation from the park board. Bob Goodman, after many, many years of service, has resigned for personal reasons, and we want to thank Bob for his years of service. And our new park board member is Carrie Weaver, married to Brad. Brad Weaver, state policeman and high school board member, school board member, high school board member, and has a lot of interest in the park program. I have kids involved in the park program. I think it's going to be a good addition. Carrie will join us at our next meeting. Anything else for Mason? Okay, thank you, Mason. Terry is not here. He wanted me to say that didn't have anything right offhand to report about the redevelopment commission, but more to come next month. So it was a pretty grueling day. Terry's going for, I think, a bit of sleep. It was pretty vigorous day. The BZA and Council on Aging, Marty?
I'll do Council on Aging first. We met yesterday, had kind of a busy meeting. The first thing is we realized we've got 5 board members that have been on the board for a year or less, so next month we're going to go through like a board orientation meeting just to talk about the various funding avenues that are, it is different in the funding process down there. And just doing a little flow chart on how money flows in and just exactly how we spend Council on Aging meeting money. So we did have discussion of a fundraiser, not really ready to report on the decisions there, but maybe looking at a raffle of some kind. That is still under discussion. If you've been in the building, you know there is a kitchen. We renovated and improved that down there, and the cleaning contract has actually been with Area 5. And we had discussions about just exactly how, since we've spent some money and renovated, we want to maybe keep it a little neater and a little cleaner and a little more diligence with the cleaning. So we've entered into a new cleaning contract with Area 5. Good news, REMC, Council on Aging did receive $750 from the Roundup grant program. So we'll figure out, I think that money is probably going to go to one of the new vehicles. May 14, a reminder, if anybody's interested, is the golf outing, which is going to be out at the Elks. May 19, the senior games at the senior center. If you haven't been there for those, they are kind of a hoot and fun to watch a little bit. The contract has been agreed upon with the roofing project, so the building is going to be re-roofed here soon. They're scheduling, fitting that into the contractor's schedule. Did hire a new assistant for Georgia Moody, the director of Council on Aging. We continue to be up by 500 or so on rides for the year. In the month of March, they did 4,029 trips with Fulton County Transpo. That's up. That alone is up 250 from 2015. And as far as BZA is concerned, we do have a meeting tomorrow night, which is our first meeting of the year. And there are 4 things on the agenda, none of which I don't think are going to be too big for the zoning, pretty small issues. So any questions?
No questions.
That's it.
Thank you, Marty. Solid Waste and Animal Adoption Center, Chase.
For the animal shelter, there was nothing very pressing at the last meeting. We've talked with Kenny Anderson about helping us with the new building. He's kind of given us a rough draft, and I think we're supposed to meet with him maybe this week or next week about more in depth of what he hopes to do with us and stuff and help us out. And then on the solid waste, we had a board meeting April 20th, and the recycling center shipped 60.5 tons of recyclables with a value of $3,801.25. For the month of February 2016, the county lines, they received 16,072.81 tons of waste in 23 working days for a daily average of 699 tons per day. Fulton County accounted for 4,099.41 tons. The rest of Indiana contributed 11,973.40 tons. There was no out-of-state trash collected, and the host fee was $18,984.95. And then there was another thing about the pay-as-you-throw program that Stacy was going to talk about, but I think that's later down, isn't there? So that concludes my report.
I'll direct my question to Stacy. That 4,129 tons of Fulton County activity, have you gotten enough information from local haulers yet to compare what their tonnage has been against that figure?
I've only gotten information from like Mike's Trash and the Foundry and like Jason. They're pushing those three about probably 3,000 tons a month.
Okay, so just those three are you're seeing 3,000 tons. Okay. And they're reporting 4,129. Okay. Any chance you'll get, you think you get any information from Bob in the month to come?
I have not, no. I did talk to him today, but he didn't have any of that information yet.
Okay. Okay. Any questions for Chase? Tree Board and EMS, Councilman Fitzwater.
Tree Board met here on April 7th. First topic we talked about was the possibility of getting an impact grant for newer trees on Main Street, about in the smaller trees. Looking at a grant of, to cover about 75 trees, 225 a tree. So, they can put the proposal in and see if they can get that to continue doing what they've been doing the past several years, but replacing those trees there. Next big item was the continued discussion about the new contract and bid letter. Once the discussion was done, it was approved. It's my understanding that the letters have gone out inviting any and all services to come in and bid.
And we seem to have had a lot of interest, haven't we? Have more than just a couple that are.
I hope so. I mean, get different ideas about who would, who did that, or who had done, whatever work we've done here or there, just send a letter, see if they're interested.
Okay.
Then the last big item was that the city did receive its Tree City designation again. So, with all that entails, we do have that. But I do believe that you are doing something on Arbor Day then next to.
I'm making a proclamation on Arbor Day. Now, I stand up on top of the building and do that, or I'll bet you would.
Tom has a ladder truck.
Stop to say, bring the ladder truck.
Yeah. Okay.
Get the mayor out of a tree.
Get him out of the tree. Yeah.
Tall's tree.
Okay. How about EMS, Councilman?
The EMS board met at the county building. The prior meeting minutes were approved under the old business. The computer switchover is still in progress, but they reported no problems with it. The radios are still on order, and once they come in, they'll be switching over whatever they need to do for that. I believe at the previous meeting, I mentioned that Lutheran was providing some Narcan bags to law enforcement officers. Those are in. Once the officers are trained, they'll be having them with them in their cars to help overdoses. There are new stair chairs and pumps on the trucks, so it will certainly help the EMTs and paramedics getting people where they need to be. They're continuing to renegotiate or revise the mutual aid agreements with the surrounding agencies. All that seems to be going well. And the which is going to cut down my reports. They're going to be starting quarterly meetings. So the next meeting will be in July. Mm. Okay. They don't have to do much anymore. There's no reason to meet every month.
Okay. Got your Narcan bag, Sandy?
No. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, any questions for Councilman Fitzwater? Okay, Councilman Garrett, Water Board.
Yes, well, first I'd like to thank Derek for giving my report. He did it for that. At the Water Board meetings, everything, we've been praising Derek for that job he's doing. He's doing a very good job for y'all. You don't know how much he puts into this, and this was just an extra gift. And, well, thank you, Derek. But,
he has asked that we eliminate the board.
But, I did take as a what, a week and a half ago, I did go down to the water building and see the, and the out exterior looks wonderful. Those eaves on the outside, which were giving us so much problems on the inside. The outside of the building really looks nice. The locks and of course the light we talked about, the red light for the chlorine in case there was an accidental spill where the fire department can come with their Scott air packs in there instead of the guys walking in on that. That's a safety precaution that Derek came up with. I thought it was very, very good. But I went inside, turned on all the lights and looked at it, and he called me about the two bronze plaques after the meeting's over. Derek, if you're here, I do have a solution for getting those cleaned. I've found something that we can do to clean the plaques. That was from the chlorine, and it made the plaques bronze, just turned sure. kind of green and everything. Yeah. But I've got a solution for we can shine those up. Got that from some people. And other than that concludes my report.
John, I have to concur with your comments. You went inside, of course, and saw the inside of the...
Oh, my word, yeah. I went and turned on all the lights, and you almost got to put sunglasses on now.
We've got some really good people working at the city, and Derek is the epitome of that. He's very proactive. Even does John's report.
Yeah, that's a plus.
But we thank you. Thank you for your efforts. Good thank report. You. Anybody got any questions for Derek? John or Derek?
Have you covered any other committee report?
Marty needs a little help there.
Area plan meets like twice a year. That?
No. Wonderful. Good job. Thanks, John. Okay, new business. Solid Waste District presentation. Stacy Hart, you're up.
I'm going to let Roger go first.
Oh, my.
Good evening, Ed.
Hi, Stacy.
Obviously, I'm not Stacy, but Stacy's here. We'll be stepping up to the lectern here shortly. She had asked me to maybe make a few comments and maybe help put in better perspective the program that she'll be proposing here shortly. I'm saying a few words because I am the senior member on our board, and I've been on there, well, this will be my 16th year now, and then before that I was on the Solid Waste Advisory Committee, which actually goes back to the beginning of the Solid Waste District back in the early 1990s. And so I got a good, real good sense of context and perspective on pretty much on the whole effort as it's developed within the county. And even before that, involved with the what they call the Fulton County Recycling, which operated at the old junior high school where the Community Resource Center is now. So. We've come a long ways in 20 plus years, tonight, as Chase mentioned, we'll be talking about the pay-as-you-throw program, but I think what we really need to emphasize is that we're going to be talking about that in the context of the curbside program also, because these two things that are kind of going hand in hand, and of course, curbside has really been subject to a lot of activity and change in the last year or two. And kind of just quickly review, for years we'd operated, it was operated through the Solid Waste District, providing curbside pickup within the city. And it was done on a contract basis, and the Solid Waste paid that contract. And then it was, as it, what and what's happening in this whole time, of course, is that our revenue to the Solid Waste District has been shrinking as the tipping fee to landfill, which of course reflects the amount of waste coming in there, has been declining over a number of years. The magic $33,333.33 number, we have not hit that, which is the Waste District's fee, or the allotment they have coming in. The first $33,000 coming in goes to them. We haven't hit that in, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 years, something like that. And so it, and not only have we not hit it, but it seems to continue to shrink, and we're down to less than $20,000 a month now, and really no reason to believe that's going to change at all in the, well, at least not in the foreseeable future anyway. So with that, there's been discussion about where curbside is going to go, what we're going to do with curbside, and of course it was curtailed for a while, and then it came back. Discussing that with Mayor Spiley, we worked out an arrangement where the city would share with some of the, their resources, and the county would kick in, or the Solid Waste District would kick in some money. And I think that was pretty much meant to be kind of a stopgap thing. But it was decided then that here around the end of last year, we were going to, you know, terminate it completely. Of course, within all this, now we had kind of a change of administration here, and I really sympathize with you, Mayor Denton, in that you kind of got caught in the crossfire of this whole thing, because we had kind of oriented this thing. I think we were going one direction with Mayor Smiley, and then of course he's out of the picture now, and so you kind of come into the situation and having to pick up. I mean, I guess I apologize that we have to have you in the middle of this thing like that, but that's kind of the way it is.
Well, I want to compliment you, Roger. You're the first one to sympathize with me since I came into this.
First time for everything. But okay, so as of the first of the year, we were willing to take some action in terms of where what we're going to do with curbside, and there's not a lot of, there had not been a lot of interest in continuing the curbside pickup program, just because we're trying to pull in our reach a little bit. You know, of course, one time we had a lot of money and we were giving out grants and everything, and we were doing a lot of good things for the community, and then that has been changing, and this is the late, one of the latest ones. So there was some debate within our board about what are we going to do, how are we going to do it, and about curbside. But I think what I'll put it in better perspective is the fact that we need to think not first about the curbside, but where we are going as a Solid Waste District, because our mandate as a Solid Waste District had been from the beginning. We had a 20-year plan that was put together in 1993 when the Solid Waste District began, about we're supposed to, our purpose in life is to divert resources, or divert the material from the landfill, the recyclable component, and try to extend the life of the landfill. And so we embarked on a recycling program through that period of time, and have done everything we can to try to maximize the amount of recyclables. But I think one of my personal frustrations, having sat through this whole thing, is that over time we have reached a plateau or a stagnation point where we are not continuing to grow. I think when you have to rely on voluntary recycling efforts, there's only so much you can do to get people to recycle, and you try to make it as easy as you can, of course, and we've done all that, but there's only so much you can do. And so we have to ask where we're going, and what we desperately need in this community is a way to incentivize recycling. Because the way the program currently stands, or the way the system currently stands, as a, if you are a dedicated recycler, you are in effect subsidizing the non-recycler, because if you have a trash pickup, which most of us do because we all generate trash, you pay the same whether you recycle or whether you don't. And so that really amounts to a subsidy, because I know in my personal situation, I recycle virtually everything we can from our household trash, and we produce very little landfill trash. And yeah, I pay the same thing as the guy down the road who doesn't recycle at all. So the problem is that we do not do anything to incentivize recycling. If the more, it should be a situation where the more you recycle, the less you pay for trash disposal. That would be a fair way to do it. And that is where this PAID program hopefully will take us, and that's the purpose for making this proposal. We really need to make a decision about how curbside will fit in with that, and it's necessary that and urgent that we do that, because we want to get this thing going. So and with that, I think we'll turn it over to Stacy, and she'll explain the details of the pay-as-you-throw program and how it all fits together.
Hello, I'm Stacy. I don't know if everybody has a copy of this, but I'll send it around. You can take a copy and read it. What we're proposing for the city to participate along with us as a kind of a group thing to incentivize recycling, as Roger was saying, it's called a pay-as-you-throw program. The residents pay for each unit of waste discarded rather than paying a fixed or per rent household fee. As residents pay directly for waste service, they have a financial incentive to reduce their waste through recycling and reduction, obviously. The solid waste, we're implementing this program to promote recycling, to cut the amount of trash going to landfills. 50 to 60% of all the trash that goes to landfill is recycled material. It's recyclable material. I mean, there's that much still going to the landfill. And without an incentive, it's really gonna continue to go there. People think, well, I have to pay a trash bill, I might as well just throw it away. And that's the problem with a lot of it, is they already have it in their head that they're gonna pay that amount. So why do I need to recycle? And that's what we're trying to get past with people. And as you can see, there's like the advantages, and it lists them. And it says, you know, fairness. Residents pay only for the amount of trash they generate. The households that generate less trash pay less, obviously. It decreases the trash tons disposed and associated. It decreases the community's residential trash tonnage. In some places, it's 35 to 50%. So we pay a lot of, we pay for a lot of things at the solid waste district that a lot of people don't realize that we do. We have a household hazardous waste program that we accept all your household hazardous waste, whether you're a city, your county, it doesn't matter. We take it, we accept it for free, and we dispose of it. We pay the cost, we eat the cost to do that. The same thing with tires.
Why?
Well, at the time, we could afford it.
Okay. All right.
It's the same thing with the recycling end of it. And I'm not saying that's not going to change. I mean, it might have to. We don't want to, you know, we don't want to see the solid waste district go away, and I don't think anybody else really does either, because of the benefit that we have to the community. Like I said, you know, we do a lot of other things that a lot of people don't understand that we pay for. But what we're proposing, the pay-as-you-throw program is kind of like a bag. They call it a bag program or whatever. We are going to sell the bags, and this is an example of a bag. We're going to sell these for $3 a bag.
when they bring in their recycling, they're also going to bring us their trash. We will dispose of their trash separately than the recycling. The whole point is to get people to buy the bags. The less you put in here, the more recycling, so the less money you're spending. We're proposing it to the city that they do this program along with the curbside recycling to incentivize and subsidize the curbside program. Because there is probably, there is enough money there to be made to subsidize that program. I don't know if you got the price or the sheet that she sent you, the original one, where it showed the Akron, the town of Akron does this program. They call it a bag tag program. They actually sell the tags that you put on your bag, and then the city of Akron picks up the bags. And it's, you know, it subsidizes their program. And they have money to buy. They use the money, the extra money that they do, to put towards like trucks and equipment and stuff like that. Program there, and there's different ways you can do the program. It doesn't have to be done that exact way. There's other, I mean, the way we do it is going to be different than the way you would do it. Like I said, they would bring us their trash bags and their recycling. The curbside, the city, we would, our recommendation would be to do the program and pick it up as like a chaser truck behind your recycle or something. And on those lines, you know, that'd be something that you guys would work through and come up with.
Would you then, as the recycling center, take that bag to the landfill?
Yes.
That's a total biodegradable bag and all that stuff? Or?
Yeah. And then these bags are... they're from a company that really is in charge of, like, it's called Waste Zero. They're a big company that they produce the bags. They have a lot of information on their website too about the pay as you throw programs. We ordered orange bags for ours. I mean, obviously, if the city would do something, they would have to order a different color bag. That way we knew
what... Some of the observers would like to see the bag.
Oh.
You hold it up.
Obviously, that's not going to say for us, but this is just an example. But the city would want to have a different color bag so we could keep them straight. You know, we wouldn't want to be disposing of your bags.
Is that about 30 gallons?
Yeah, it's about 28.
Oh my gosh, okay.
It's obviously bigger than a normal household trash can. But if you were a very good recycler, you probably use one bag a week, if that. Or less. I mean, right. And that's the whole point that we're trying to do here, is to get people to recycle more so they don't have trash. Any questions?
The county is moving forward, yes, with this. And how soon are you?
I've already ordered the bags. Like 3 to 6 weeks to get the bags. So as soon as the bags come in the meantime, I'm going to be doing some advertising and stuff to promote the whole program.
Can you determine pricing for an individual with that bag?
Yeah, we're thinking $3 a bag.
There's only one bag size?
We can order other bag sizes. I figured we would start with one, see how that works out, and then go from there.
And you're going to have a follow-along truck out the county highway that'll go around and pick them up in the county and bring them to your...
Oh. Nope, you have to take it to the recycling center when you bring us. The county people that participate in our recycling program bring us their recycling anyways. So, except for the ones that use the trailers, but that's where we come in to incentivize the whole program is.
Well, and the question I think that's being posed to the city would be the fact that we, you know, being an integral part of the Solid Waste District, being an integral part of the curbside program for a number of years, so we see the value in that, and it has some merit, but I think it's probably the will of the board that we do not wish to continue to subsidize it indefinitely, and so the option for the city to participate and create a similar program that would incorporate curbside is what needs to be considered by you folks. I think the decision of the board would be that to try to incentivize that, the board would be willing to continue to subsidize as we currently do at the current rate through the end of this year, if you're interested in starting such a program.
And then what would you do after that? Well, if the city invests two people in equipment to do the curbside recycling and then two people in a follow-along truck to pick up trash, what is the Solid Waste / County willing to do to subsidize that?
Well, the point is that we wish to bring our subsidy to an end, and if the example that's being done in Akron is at all realistic, then it's probably such a thing that you would be able to generate some, if not all, of the additional funds needed to make the program work within the city.
Well, am I not right in saying that the city of Akron has a trash hauler that is picking those bags up?
No, the city does it themselves.
Well, now, didn't we talk to a trash hauler that's involved with that in my office?
Right. The city picks it up and takes it back to the city hall there, and they dump it in their dumpsters. And then they have a trash hauler come pick it up.
At any rate, and here's the problem I have, you know the problem. I don't want to see the city go into the trash business. Number one, we don't have the resources. And number two, I'm not interested in competing with long-standing business people out there who are making their living doing this. And now you got somebody that's saying, I'm not going to pay $27 a month. I'm going to pay $3 a week and cut Mike's trash or Bob's trash or Waste Management's trash out of the loop. I'm not interested in doing that to somebody who's a taxpayer who's running a business in our community. I don't think we belong in that business. That's my personal opinion.
How much is the subsidy that we get?
$1,400 a month.
$1,700.
Or $1,700 a month.
So another alternative, if we want to continue curbside recycling, is if they stop the subsidy, we come up with the $1,800 a month.
$1,700 a month.
We just don't receive that revenue. We just wouldn't receive any revenue. We would be putting out the expense for the truck and the drivers.
And to give you some idea of the activity, we are picking up at 562 households throughout the city.
So for the bag program, if the city were to decide to go that route, we'd sell our own bags.
Right. And you would keep your own money. And then you would.
So they'd like come to City Hall to buy their bags?
Right.
Okay.
And you would dispose of the bags.
So we collect it and then we would then haul it to.
And we do have some trash haulers here in this county that pick up some trash that does not go to our landfill. And that's where I'm upset at the whole fact too, is that they're taking our in-county trash and taking it to other counties. Well, and we're not getting paid on that money.
And the other fact that we learned in talking to these people is some of these trash haulers also pick up curbside recycling for other communities, but they don't sort it. They pick it up bulk, and take it to the solid equivalent of our solid waste district, dump it, and it's sorted there.
And they say they do.
They say they do.
Right.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean it's being done properly.
Well, that's a trust thing, but right. This whole program's based on trust. We trust the landfill. Right. You know.
Well, I can remember the last time when we were discussing about, you know, going and eliminating the private haulers. Mm-hmm. I don't know about anybody else, but my phone rang off the wall for a while.
Yeah, those are business people.
Yes. I like the idea, but it's also...
So really, for like a trash bill for normal households, what, about 20 to 25 a month?
27 bucks.
27, so that's 9 bags of trash. If you buy it at $3 a bag. I don't know. I mean, it's 9 bags.
And I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we have some haulers that actually charge up towards the $40 a month.
I know Waste Management, they charge $170 to $190 for 3 months.
Yeah, I see that. Some of them do them quarterly like that. So I think it just depends on the hauler you use, too.
Yeah.
The way you're going to pay.
And then you're going to put it in a dumpster, and one of these people will haul the dumpster away, right?
Mm-hmm. Or I'm looking into a
compactor. So when is the county starting their program?
As soon as I get the bags, which I'm hoping by the 1st of June, with it being 4 to 6 weeks for bags. But
so let's say the city doesn't do the program. Mm-hmm. Could city residents still come and buy bags there?
Yes.
Okay. Which would be good for the county.
Right.
Make some money off that end. When would you like an answer from the city in regards to the subsidy? If we're going to do that or not?
Before our next meeting.
When's the next meeting?
Tomorrow.
Tonight after this one.
The third Wednesday of the
month. Third
Wednesday. Well, if we're not ready to vote tonight, we won't have another meeting prior to that meeting.
Well, yeah, we could.
For tax abatement. So that'd be a good time to do our research and discuss it. That way we can get you an answer as quickly as we can. I don't know if it comes to a vote to us. I mean, who makes that decision? You know, is that the mayor? Is that the board of works? Is that us?
You're talking about the resources, the actual physical resources of the city, the labor, and also the hard resources, equipment. Mm-hmm. We have to make some budget adjustments and changes. Mm-hmm. You're talking about street department needing, you know, we've squeezed that street department till it's dry. And we wrestle with this just about weekly, don't we, Lenny Warren, with the curbside pickup. How are we going to dole the labor out? We only have 5 people to utilize throughout the street department, and we've used part-timers, and we've looked at other creative ways to do it, and it's very time-consuming, very time-consuming. So, you know, if we were to take on more, and we're not even at least getting the gas money every month, $1,700, and that basically is what that goes to, we're going to have to do some budgetary things. Am I not right, guys? I mean, you tell me.
Yeah, you're right.
You
want
to try to come up with a couple more bodies to...
Yeah, it puts a strain on us because we lose 3 people every week. You know, we lose 2 people every week for 3 days. And, you know, we only got, like you say, 5 guys. And so, you know... last year we had the issue of getting all the leaves up, you know. Well, that was like the first leaf season with picking up the recycling, and it was rough, and we had a lot of complaints, and I know we got behind the eight ball, but it was tough on us. So
then you get one of the recyclers that are sick, then you got to subsidize, you know, them with another person that's never did it before. So that kind of slows it down too, because you know you got this person that's, you know, he don't know number six plastic from, you know, whatever, you know. So it's
vacations.
Yeah.
There's all sorts of issues there in balancing that very delicate combination. I would encourage you to do this, councilman. Talk to your constituents, of your constituents between now and executive meeting. I mean, people are wanting that to happen. They've got to realize it doesn't come for free. We're going to have to do some budgetary things to make that happen. We're going to have to grow our bureaucracy.
On the lines also of not wanting to compete with the trash haulers, when you and I sat down with the two trash haulers, we explained to them what we were doing, and they know what is going on. They also, I think, realize that they can't, I mean, the question is, you know, they don't want to participate in curbside pickup. I mean, we offered that to them, you know, when we were in there, and neither one of them were interested. They do know.
I know, they didn't want to sort it. They would consider bulk pickup,
right,
like they're doing in Marshall County and over in Plaskett,
right,
County and what have you, but they don't want to, and nobody wants to take the time to sort it. You don't want to set up a conveyor belt out there and sort it. Nobody wants to do that part. Well, for it to be a successful program, someone has to do that. And the cost of that has to be absorbed from some place.
Right.
That's the whole thing in
a
nutshell.
That's where we're going with, you know, the cost being absorbed by the residents who participate.
For the town of Akron, how many households are they picking up for the trash?
I don't know.
They have about a population of 600-800, so I would say probably 400 households, maybe.
She didn't give me a definite number. I can find out.
I'm familiar with the population.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just trying to come up with the scale. I mean, if we're picking up 400 or 500 right now for curbside, you know, just assuming they participate in the program or a percentage, or we pick up some more. I mean, it's...
Stacey, how big is Whitley? Is Whitley County?
Whitley County is...
They're doing this also.
Right. Whitley County is... Well, the whole county of Whitley County is about 35,000. So, they do their program different than what we do also. I mean, they have curbside pickup for their city. This is pretty much just countywide. Their figures here doesn't include their actual city limits. There's just county residents.
Yeah, I don't think your garbage haulers got too concerned about it when they came in to see us, because I don't think they thought we would be very successful with it. That's the impression I got. I know we've got 562 households right now who recycle. That's not a lot in our community. To get people who now have to sort through their trash and put in on one bag and some put the rest in recycling, people who don't want to do that aren't going to worry about what it costs. They just won't do it.
Yeah, I mean, that's what the recyclers are doing now, though.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what we do.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
I mean, we have our bins out on the
right.
Porch and throw it away, and then throw away the rest. But so, Roger, you guys meet the 18th, I think, of May. Is that the third Wednesday?
Yeah, it's the third Wednesday.
But I would disagree with you that people are not there are not sensitive enough to price that they would be motivated to recycle. They have for so long now been in a situation where there's absolutely no financial incentive to recycle, that from what everything I've gathered talking with Stacy and the people at the recycling center, live in a community that's very much motivated by small dollar amounts. If they could shave off a significant portion of that $20, $30, $40 a month they're paying for trash pickup, I think they'd be very motivated to recycle.
Well, then why don't we let you folks in the county be the beta project? go ahead and do it.
I think the issue is, are they going to give up curbside? And I think curbside is very valuable to a lot of people. And if that's the case,
no, what I'm saying,
that's a decision that they need to make and understand that they're going to lose that thing. And they're also not going to have that option, well, at least not the option of curbside with the reduction in your trash pickup. I think between those together, continuing the curbside and then having a substantial reduction in your monthly trash pickup. And I do mean substantial, because if my household is any comparison, where we have four people, we could probably go through no more than two of those bags in a month's time, if you're a dedicated recycler. So, as you talk to your constituents, I think you need to understand that they're in position to save a lot of that $20, $30, $40 a month.
Well, I agree with what you're saying. I would hate to see curbside go away. We recycle as a household, but when all of this shifted, we stopped setting it out on the curb. We just take it into the recycling center. In terms of paying for the bags, that's about what we go through. You know, and our bill is about $25, $26 a month.
But would you go through the same amount of bags?
Yes. If you recycle, that's about the size of bags.
Can you recycle any better than what you are now at home?
I don't know. We do
a
pretty good job.
Are you a sloppy recycler?
Yeah.
You're
talking to the wrong McCall on that one.
Right.
Digs the stuff out that I throw away that can be recycled.
I mean, any kind of paper, you know.
To me, it's a break even at that point for me as a household. In terms of the city, I don't see any other way around it other than hiring more staff to be able to drive another truck behind it and pick up the additional. And then we need to sit and figure out, are we going to make enough money off of those bags to offset that enough to make it worthwhile?
Yeah, and you talk about labor intense. There are people who've made a business and a career out of this, who've invested $250,000 in equipment that you throw it in, it gets compacted, it gets dumped out, you move right along, blah, blah, blah. Now we want the city to get two or three people and a dump truck to throw them. I started out doing that when I was 18 years old, and it's not very efficient, let me tell you. I just think we're going to hear a lot of comments back from not only the citizens, but from the trash haulers. I empathize with your plight, but I think there are other ways we can increase your income.
And I'm not just talking about increasing my income. We need to focus on what's going to the landfill.
Well, you're talking about your survival out there. I know it. I mean, you're right on the edge.
They pay me for what goes out there, and I'm trying to keep stuff from going out there. So really, I'm not trying to, you know, get more money off of them. I'm trying to do the right thing and force people to recycle. That's where I'm at with it.
Then why would you threaten to stop the $1,700 for curbside pickup to the city at the end of the...
We can't keep subsidizing.
Because we can't afford it, yeah.
Can't afford that end of it. I guess I'm not as concerned about the competition of the local trash haulers. It'd be no different than a new trash hauler coming out. Could you tell them?
Well, it would be a little different. We're the city. We're not...
I mean, we're already competing with them by picking up some of their trash right now.
But we're making
in terms of recycling.
We're making that money by picking that up.
Yeah, but I see what you're saying. It's not going in the garbage can. Yeah. Can I, I'll interject for just a rough numbers because that's my job. <laughs> <laughs> If we do, how many households did you say we need? 562. Okay, so 562, if we did the three dollars for just one bag, whoops, um, right there you're at 1686. That's 14 bucks shy of what we're getting subsidized now. If we would increase that, just double it, or not even double it, let's just say we do 1,000 with $3 a bag, and that's just one bag, that's 3,000 a month, if that's per month. Mm-hmm. So potentially, we could actually end up bringing in, if we were to do this and look at this as an opportunity, we could essentially bring in more than what we're breaking bringing in with their subsidy.
Yeah, but I don't think that's any prize. I don't think the subsidy's anything to cheer about.
No, I'm just saying, yeah, as far as the equipment numbers just by themselves, that, and just with the numbers that Stacy's presented, so that's just food for thought. Yeah. I mean, I'm not saying one way or the other, I'm just, that's food for thought.
But you're not factoring in two extra people, a vehicle.
Correct.
A vehicle.
Correct.
Yeah, we're going to have an investment in it.
Yeah, because right now, the revenue that we bring in, that number came out based upon the two particular employees that are running that route, with their hourly wages plus benefits, help factor that in, plus the purchase of a trailer that we had to make. And then basically a rough estimate on the wear and tear of the truck for that we have. So that was kind of, it was one of those where we had some numbers. The previous mayor had taken it, which is probably the word to talk to Stacy, and this was the number that came up with, was the 17 number. So,
yes. How many bags did you figure there?
That was, just the 500.
The 562 households.
Yeah, I mean,
they're going to have four bags a month, probably. I mean, so if you figure that on three or four bags a month.
Oh, we have more than that.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, that'll cut the trash bill in half if they're taking four bags. So it's, the potential's there. I understand, you know, what Ted's concerned, but you know, just because there's a business there doesn't mean we can't do the right thing, and they could step up.
Well, Brian, don't get me wrong, but I mean, you guys from the county aren't sitting wearing this hat. You know, you're going to do it in the county. Okay, you want to pull the city along. I'm saying, go ahead and do it in the county. We'll look at you as a beta project. If you guys do it for 6 months and it's wonderful in the county and none of the trash haulers are complaining and everything's working like wonderful thing, I could look at it again.
The trash haulers aren't going to complain about this because they're getting a sweet deal right now, because they're getting the same amount of money from me.
But that's not my business.
When I pay my trash hauler, he doesn't care how much I recycle.
Yeah.
When I go to this system, which I will, then I'm going to get rid of that trash hauler, and I'm going to pay a very small amount.
But Roger, that's not my business. Those people are in business. Just like if you were in business and I thought you were getting $25 more for a head of cattle than you should, that's not my business. That's your business. That's how you run your business.
I don't want to subsidize these trash haulers for picking up other people's trash. I'm going to pay for mine, and then that's it. That's all I want to pay for.
Well, I guess I'm looking at it, you know, not from the trash haulers' perspective. This could be a benefit to our citizens.
Right.
Exactly. You know, it's the citizens.
Right. You know, the trash haulers have an option of participating in this, and they will not do it at this time. They might down the road. I mean, you know.
Well, they're going to have to down the road. This is the future. This is the future. Let's be clear. Mm-hmm. If you don't get into this, trash haulers don't get into this, they will be gone in 20 years.
What I'm saying, the city residents, very possibly what they're saving on their trash bill, are going to have to pay in their city taxes, because we can't limp along doing it with the current resources. We're going to have to increase our budgeting process and get more monies coming in to cover this kind of a service if we go into this business. That's the way where I'm looking at.
But the revenue will possibly offset that, potentially. Mm-hmm. We don't know yet. You have to run some numbers.
How?
I mean, you're going to get a revenue.
And first of all, nobody's talked about the split.
The trash,
who gets what?
Well, as a guinea pig, Akron is making money on the deal. So if you want a guinea pig, there's your guinea pig.
How's the split going to be? 50-50? We get a buck and a half a bag, and the solid waste will get a buck and a half a bag?
We're selling our own bags.
You're selling your own bags.
You're selling your own bags.
You're selling your own bags for the city residents. We're selling to the county residents.
Shada, you want to sell the bags? Put them out front. I don't know. It looks like something we'd have to.
And I think 562 participants in the city would increase. So, you know, there's more of a revenue than just the 562.
Yeah, I would like to see us consider this. You know, take some time, sit down, talk to people, look at the numbers. I'm certain we'll probably get some phone calls.
I would say one more thing. I mean, I'm not going to speak for the whole board, but I mean, it's something we could even look at, selling your bags for you. They could come out there, and it's not very far, and pick up the bags, and then Stacy, they can forward the money back to you. I mean, if selling a bag is an issue, I mean, that's we're there. We're so, just right over there.
So you guys are selling these bags for the county, but then the customer has to bring them to you guys.
Yes.
So why should we have to pay somebody to pick it up when we can sell the bags and the customers can bring them to you?
They can bring them to you.
Why can't they bring them to you?
Because you're going to make the money on it. I don't want to dispose of someone else's trash that I'm not making money on.
Would it benefit you guys to sell the bags
if we choose,
right? The whole point was to stop the subsidizing of the curbside.
So our dump truck.
That was why we were wanting you guys.
Our dump truck full of bags. We have to take to the landfill. The city does.
Yeah.
There we are again. There's another charge. Yeah.
The only name I know is Mike's. Mike's not want to be getting the bag, taking the bag himself.
Well, they will be picking up our trash. See, once we collect the bags, they will be dumping
in the dumpster.
Well, why is Mike not picking up himself? I guess my question.
Well, because they're not going to want to go around. I mean, this is something that they can participate. This was something brought to them that we were going to do. Unless they were interested. I mean, they could start a bag program if they wanted. They could sell the bags and pick them up if that's what they wanted to do, but they're not interested in a program like that.
Well, we've got two more employees to consider. We got a truck, we got insurance, the other Benny's. We, you know, it's a whole other business you're going into.
I mean, to do like what Mark said, it wouldn't take long to sit down and crunch numbers and put down what that would look like, depending on if we use existing employees for that, or we would bring in new, because that pay rate's going to be a little different depending. So we could certainly sit down and put those numbers to what those costs are going to be, to what either A would be an additional tax levy on us for the street for MVH, or whether this would be an option, you know, and we can certainly look at the numbers. Ted and I can bring that back to the council at the next meeting.
And I think you seriously need to consider, though, the 562 would increase. Correct. I mean, you can't go off of just what you have now.
Yeah. Well, and that's only one bag per 562. Right. So, like Mark said, you know, they generate four, you know, I know what my household generates, and we're about with four people. And
what type of increase do you think we should expect? I mean, we have to have something to go by.
I don't know that you can even guess. Can you? I mean,
I'm not going to throw a number out. No, I'm not. I don't know. Just
pick a number. I mean, if you don't know. Wouldn't know. Yes, some people will do it.
Besides Akron, even if it's in another county, is there another city that's doing this that would be approximately our population size? Do you know?
I know there's other solid waste districts that do it, but like I said, it's different in everyone.
We're definitely coming from two directions of thought on this, and I think we need a meeting, and probably in that executive meeting we can discuss it. Or not the executive, but one on the top industries. RTC viewing audience out there, I would encourage all of you, call your council people. Let them know your thoughts on this, because we need your input. We know what the input was a couple years ago. This is a new venture. Talk to your council people. Okay.
Or call the mayor.
They liked how I did that. And that's Marty Smith at Smith Sawyer. Thank you, Stacy. Tax abatement renewals, the top industries we're going to have to table, the Beacon Credit and the American Axle, are they complete?
Yes. I will tell you, Beacon Credit Union actually has withdrawn their personal property tax. They did not feel that was enough of a benefit for them to ask for a renewal, so they are no longer going to ask for that.
It's okay.
The real property.
Wonderful.
That's all that they're asking for their renewal on.
Okay.
American Axle, this is their first renewal, so, and there was an email I included. They were unable to, I don't believe we had anyone able to attend, so in his email, Matthew Casey kind of explained what Brian had said earlier about their phase two starting and where they're looking at the additional employment and things like that to stay on target with their SB1 that they filed in 2014. Thank you, guys.
Street Department.
Thank you.
Okay. Do I have a motion on the American Axle. Is that the first one we're looking at here?
Mm-hmm. I'd make a motion for the continuation of the American Axle tax abatement.
Second. Those in favor? Okay, approved. Next would be the That's it. Okay, we're gonna do top industries.
Beacon had personal property.
Oh, okay.
They let the personal go. This is the real property.
I'm sorry. Where is that? Okay. All right. Two beacons. One beacon of light. Two beacons. Do I have a motion on the beacon tax abatement for personal property?
Real property.
Real property. Okay.
I make a motion for the adoption or continued abatement.
Mason,
second.
That was a new voice. I caught that.
Those in favor? Okay, passed.
7-0.
Yep.
No, I abstained.
Oh, you abstained. Okay, that's why I was asking. 6-0-1.
You just there wants your pay increase. Okay. Next on the agenda. Well, we don't have Amy here, do we? That's right.
I can give a brief.
Can you give a brief explanation of the PA system?
What has happened is obviously those of you who've been downtown for the chili cook-off or any events that we have downtown, we do have a PA system, but it's kind of outdated and antiquated and you can't hear very well. So there's been conversation with the Chamber of Commerce, the Rochester Downtown Partnership, and I think maybe the Fedco office about, you know, what can we do about this? And one of the opportunities was there's a grant available through the Northern Indiana Community Foundation. And the chamber had said, you know, we really feel like maybe it should be a downtown partnership application grant. So the downtown partnership hasn't officially discussed this in board yet. So this is all brand new. Nobody's made any decisions to move forward on anything, but we wanted to make sure the council was aware of it, that if by chance the RDP board says, you know, we would like to help, they can't apply for the grant yet. So we were thinking that possibly the city could apply for this grant. It's about a $40,000 or $45,000 grant through the Community Foundation to replace all of the PA system downtown. It makes sense for the city to take this on simply because it's utilized by the chamber, by RDP, by the city, parades. I mean, it's utilized by a bunch of different organizations within our community. So that was where I'll own it. I'm the one who suggested the city take this as an opportunity for us to apply for it and see if we can. I think Rochester Telephone Company has been looking at what is needed, wiring that's needed, the speakers that are needed, and come up with a rough figure on what it's going to take to upgrade that. So,
Shada, we've actually had a presentation at our design committee, and the telephone company it's going to get hosted. The system will be hosted at the courthouse, and the telephone company is offering their people for no cost to run the wiring. We're looking at the speaker boxes. We've had quotes on number of poles. They've come and inspected the poles. There's actually thought of moving the system, extending it on north on Main Street, maybe down a block off of Main Street to the east and the west. So, and again, it is a matter of who's going to apply for the grant.
Yeah.
But I believe that it's Scott Zion has pretty much gotten the estimates together for the project.
This is repairing the.
It is replacing all the speakers, running new wires. Obviously, the wires into the courthouse will be run underground. Then they'll run pole to pole from for the speakers. They're one of the problems with the project is getting a wire, a speaker wire strong enough to span the distance from speaker to speaker. So it's going to be a, not each speaker is going to run to the courthouse. It'll run from speaker to speaker. So when they, then the idea is to expand this even more in years to come. The car show now comes way down to the north of Main Street now, and they really can't hear announcements down there when they're announcing it at, you know, 8th and Main. So.
And do those speakers, are they left up year round?
Yes, they are. Okay. The idea being with the new servers for the system, there can also be Christmas music run through, for instance. So on a weekend that downtown merchants are going to have a project or something.
Wonderful.
Special music.
Neat.
At any particular time. And the speakers are obviously a higher quality than what's up there now. So, and run on existing light poles that are here now.
And I'm not sure what the deadline, do you know what the deadline is? Because that was the one question I, or the one answer I don't have, is what the actual deadline was for that grant.
I don't know why June's in my head, but I don't.
That's kind of what I was thinking. But I wanted to bring it to the council just to get feedback. You know, if you guys are in favor of it and the mayor's office is in favor of it, I don't mind handling the grant application and making sure we get everything done in the name of the city and get it turned in, because obviously I'm going to be filling out 90% of it anyway because of the financials. So, but we just, it was one of those, and on all the conversations I've had with folks about it, it just made the most sense for us to be the applicant as far as the city. As opposed to...
Do you know offhand the cost for the project?
They were looking at the 40 to 50 range, thousands, was the last number I heard. I have not talked to Scott to find out what the...
With a grant of how much towards that?
Well, I think it was a full match.
Full match?
Yeah. I believe. So, and even if we were, if there is a little bit that we would have to put out financially, I think we would be able to do that if we needed to. That load, I mean, even if it's
20%,
I'm sure we would be able to come up with that.
Okay.
Sounds great.
Good.
Sounds
great.
Go for it.
Great, good. Go for it. Okay, so if you're in favor, Ted, I mean,
I think it's a great project. Yeah.
I will let Amy know then that the city will be in favor of being the applicant for that, so it takes that off her plate. I will get in touch with Jay or...
But I'll talk to Harry with the design committee to make sure he knows that.
Yeah. Now, I guess in that statement, do any of you have any questions or concerns with us partnering with the Downtown Partnership on this and allowing them to have their name along with ours, not on the application, obviously, but their design committee is the one that's been speaking with them. Our board is the one that's been trying, or we will be discussing it at the next board meeting. So do you guys have any issues with sharing that partnership with them?
I can't think of where there would be.
You have four council members that are on various boards in that organization, so.
Well, I'm not.
I didn't.
Yeah. Wait a minute. Which four?
Can you tell which one's not?
Yeah.
And pretty well tied with the area.
Four
place
standard.
Yeah.
The one that needs to have another committee that does actually meet, yeah. I think.
It's once a month.
Quite a bit.
Okay. I appreciate that, gentleman, very much.
And I'll start Skyping you.
Pass that on to our board as well. Okay.
Thanks, Shada. Pretty good little Reader's Digest version of Amy's report, I'm sure.
I probably kept mine much shorter.
You certainly did.
Yes.
God love her.
Yes. You guys are being
that was on TV. That was on TV.
That made TV, but yeah, Amy, you know, we love you. Okay, Andy, anything from the legal side of things?
Just a quick follow-up. Marty mentioned the 9th Street property and what dates were worked out. There was in February, there was an agreement.
Could you project for the TV people, please? Thank you. Right? Can you hear him?
In February, there was an agreement entered with the court that work would start no later than May 1st, and there is a follow-up hearing on the 4th, as you read from tomorrow. That's mainly to to force an official progress report. And by the way, those are, it's the contract purchaser who made that agreement, McIntyre, to get that done. So we have, in addition to your conversation, we do have something on the court calendar to kind of move that along, if necessary.
Well, there's what your name first date.
Yeah, very good. Interesting. Thank you. Anything else?
Nothing else.
I have no ordinance resolutions. Any other business, gentlemen?
Do we want to set our meeting
date?
Do we want to look at the Tuesday before?
Well,
look at this.
Do you want to do it in the evening, or would you like to do a lunch meeting?
How quick do we have to meet for tops?
It's on it. I just have to make sure that I have everything. Brian's signature, my signature, and it filed in my office and to the auditor by May 15th.
I think Terry said they would have everything ready by Monday, next Monday.
Yeah, so I'm saying, if you guys are available next week, or if you want to push it out to the next week, it's kind of a
Well, not if you need it by May 15th.
Mm-hmm. Let's get it done.
Well, no, we got a couple weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Get it done early. Get it done.
I'm going to meet tomorrow.
Yeah. Well, midnight.
What are we looking at? Didn't we say?
Any particular day? Anyone?
Any day?
Maybe May 10th?
May 10th?
No. I won't be here. Softball?
Actually, not softball. Well, evening, yes, but I'll be in Indianapolis for another day.
Well, we can do a lunch, can't we?
There you go.
Well, she won't be here.
That doesn't say. I'll be in
She'll
Indianapolis
be on the 10th.
Okay.
How about the 9th?
You buying lunch?
9th.
I might even pop for lunch.
Mayor will buy lunch. It's
Mayor
on
will buy lunch. Jeez.
Do you want to do lunch?
Does what day of the week is the 9th?
Monday.
Hold on. Darren.
Y'all like soup, don't you?
I'm
making chili. There's microwave in here.
I could do a lunch meeting on the 9th.
Cup of soup.
Not the evening.
Not you, yeah.
I could be here.
May the 9th.
You're the one I'm worried about.
Noon? Yeah, noon here?
Noon for everybody.
Okay. Okay.
What's my is this a board meeting? Board meeting, yes. Second Monday of the month, but I can make other arrangements there.
Are you sure? Because we could look at this, what is Wednesday?
Oh, yeah. I can't ask the vice president to cover it for me. He's right here. So
aren't I supposed to be there too?
I
don't
yes,
have
you
my
are.
Calendar in front of me.
So how about Wednesday?
Oh, right. Yeah, we're going to another day.
How about Wednesday the 11th at noon?
Works for me.
That would actually work better.
Nail her down. Wednesday the 11th.
That's my
just nail down day.
Come on.
That's our Kiwanis meeting. So I'm president of Kiwanis. I'm out on Wednesday.
Thursday the 12th?
Marty, how about you tell us what day you are?
What's Marty's schedule?
Thursday is great.
Thursday the 12th, everybody. What do you think?
I'm out. Oh, no, I'm really out.
And I could meet on election day if we wanted to do it on Tuesday.
I'm out.
Yeah.
During the day?
Yeah.
Out of Thursday?
Well, yeah,
do it on Wednesday, and I'll try to make arrangements for Kiwanis.
Wednesday what?
Okay. Wednesday the 11th.
You and I will skip together.
May the 11th at noon.
May 11th at noon.
Noon here, okay.
Noon okay. Here on the 11th.
I have one other piece of new business before.
I'm
Pardon?
Sorry.
Okay, I have one other piece of new business before we adjourn. A brand new father sitting up here, and I'd like to congratulate, and all of you join me in congratulating Mason Heidi, is the proud father of a little girl, Harper Olivia Heidi. If you can say that 10 times in a row, you get a prize. Very, very good. Congratulations. Mother and daughter are doing well.
Is it ours?
Yeah. I probably have some at home.
Mother and daughter are doing well, correct? Great. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Okay. Thank you very much, gentlemen.